CSV for having invited me to the meeting. And in fact, I'm afraid that my talk will be probably the most elementary one because it's deterministic, linear, self-adjoint. this is actually to be a kind of summary of several papers written in collaboration with various people, so most of them are French, except this guy who is apparently Italian. The whole talk is dedicated to the spectral study of the Robin Laplacian. So we had a small discussion. Robin was a French mathematician, the Robin boundary condition is called sometimes the boundary condition of the third kind by analogy with the first kind, which is Dirichlet, and the second kind, which is Neumann. So if I take a suitably regular open set omega in Rd, so just to make it geometric, I assume that the dimension is at least 2. And if I choose a real number alpha, then the Robin Laplacian, which I will denote q omega alpha, it will be due to the self-adjoint operator in L2 omega. And informally it is defined this way. So it acts as a minus Laplacian. And so the normal derivative at the boundary, the outer normal derivative at the boundary is proportional to the value of the function on the boundary. So what is important here is, first of all, the fact that this is an outer normal. So maybe I will write it because I don't need it in folders. Okay, it maps you the Laplacian. Okay, in the end, this is alpha omega. Okay, in fact, on the image you see that the domain is non-smooth, and actually this is an essential point because it will be duplicate rocky, but...
I'm sorry, nobody else cares, but I care a lot, so I'm going to ask anyway. What is the gross domain of which you can define
Laplacian? This is what I'm going to say at the moment to them for the next line. In fact, I don't care in fact, I will do it with variational methods, and to do it with variational methods, I do it proceed as follows. So I consider, I consider this form. And if this form is closed as unbounded from below, then it defines a unique self-adjoint operator. So informally, this operator looks this way, and this is exactly the operator I'm going to denote by q omega alpha. So in fact, for the compact Lipschitz domain, I think everyone agrees.
But then it's worse. Can you actually go into, for example, can you, to the extreme of it, can you go to fractal?
No, fractal, for the moment I can't, and I'm not going to. But anyway, you can admit some local singularities like cusps, which are not very sharp. But the problem still makes sense, I would say, somewhat. But anyway, this is not the point. I mean, actually, already in the Lipschitz setting, there are some problems to solve. So, in fact, in all works on this topic, we in fact work with this sesquilinear linear form and not with the operator itself. So, and we will be interested in the spectral properties of this operator, in particular in the eigenvalues. So the eigenvalues of an operator will be denoted by Ej, so when they are enumerated in the usual way. And in particular, I will be very interested in the asymptotic regime when alpha goes to plus infinity. So in fact, if you look at the expression for the CSP linear form, you see that we have minus alpha here, so it means that let's say if you put any function into the form when alpha goes to plus infinity, so essentially it's, except if the function vanishes on the boundary, it goes to minus infinity. So, maybe for those who are not in the business, so let me recall that this is sufficient. This form is sufficient to define, okay, again, under suitable assumptions, for example, in the domain of the Lipschitz or something not very far from Lipschitz, that the Sesky linear form is sufficient to describe the eigenvalues of this operator. Okay, they are given by, so this is the min-max formula, but in particular, okay, the first eigenvalue is the first eigenvalue is simply given by the formula in H1 omega, since integral square S omega and then omega square X. Okay, this is a well-known formula for the first eigenvalue. So, and it's relatively easy to show that, in fact, in this asymptotic regime, so the whole topic is in fact dedicated to this asymptotic regime. In fact, if you pick a number j, then the associated eigenvalue will go to minus infinity, and the associated eigenfunction will be localized near the boundary. One can describe it with the help of Eigenvalue instances, but okay, it's exponentially localized near the boundary. So again, in fact, there is no, for the moment, there are no strict assumptions of the domain. This comes later. For the moment, the assumption that this form is closed and simply bounded from below. So let us discuss first what can we say about from the general principles, let's say. So assume that our domain is bounded Lipschitz. Okay, then there is a very well known estimate from the theory of Sobolev spaces. So in particular, this basic estimate shows that the first eigenvalue goes to minus infinity, but the speed can be at most quadratic in alpha. This is actually quite trivial. But then, of course, one can be interested in the optimization of this constant. So if we are interested in the optimization of this constant, or more precisely in the asymptotic behavior of the first or next eigenvalues, so far there are no results in the general Lipschitz setting, so but under slightly strong assumptions. So the strong assumptions is somehow which comes from the school, from the French school, which is called the corner domain. I mean, this is the distance of tangent cones at some every point, and somehow tangent cones are supposed to be somehow isomorphic to the neighborhoods. I mean, let's say this way smooth and this tangent cones.
You have a friend.
Okay, I learned it while being in France, so for me it's a French theory, but of course it's a
Lavrentia.
Yeah,
exactly.
Okay, no, I'm surrounded by people from the French.
Of course,
in
France.
Okay,
let's
be nice to French.
Okay, let's say under suitable assumptions for a large class of non-smooth domains, it was shown that the first eigenvalue really behaves quadratically in alpha square, and moreover, one can actually describe this constant in some reasonable way. So, in particular, this constant is at least one, and moreover, one can express it, in fact, in the following way. So I'm not going to give an exact definition of a tangent cone, but okay, in two dimensions, you can intuitively understand it like this. If you have a piecewise smooth domain, then if it's smooth, then the tangent cone is the half plane, and if there is a corner, then it's the infinite center. Okay, these sets, they are infinite, but anyway, the Robin Laplacian is still well defined, in particular, then this number E1 is actually the bottom of the spectrum of the Robin Laplacian is the associated infinite set. So then if you do the infimum over the whole boundary, then this gives exactly the constant in this asymptotic. One needs precise assumptions in order to be sure that actually this infimum is actually finite. Okay, this is anyway somehow it's still actually some exit direction, and moreover this asymptotics also appears when you take an infimum at each point. Somehow it also appears in many other problems. So maybe I say a word about our recent paper with Hinikovacic about domains with peaks. I mean, domains which are non-Lipschitz. So I mean, if you have a kind of power, let's say power like cusp, like x2 is smaller than, let's say, P, then, in fact, in order to define the, in order to be able to look at the problem, you need to assume that P is between 1 and 2, because if 1 is Lipschitz and 2 is, if it's 2 or bigger than 2, then the Robin Laplacian is not well defined. In fact, the first eigenvalue is not well defined. So in that case, the first eigenvalue is not quadratic anymore, so essentially, here, the main term can be divergent with any polynomial speed. Okay, this is not the case. It was just, let's say, for fun, for example. So for the moment, there is nothing more serious than that. So now let me discuss a bit in greater detail the smooth domains. So why are the smooth domains better than non-smooth domains? Because they have the normal variable which is defined in globally. So in fact, if you have a smooth domain omega, then you can introduce here's a normal variable. Let's say assume that P is positive. Section room, so this is just puppet. So then in fact, if you do proper computations, you can, so then I will have another variable which lives on the boundary. So if you do the proper computations, which is in fact also need some boxes, it's not just a straightforward computation, but there is some analysis, then you can obtain a kind of separation of variables with respect to t. So it's not a complete separation of variables, but anyway, you can get rid of this variable, and you essentially you continue with some problem which is just lives on the boundary. So in the normal direction, in fact, the operator essentially looks like the second derivative. And with the Robin boundary condition and zero, and in fact, this problem can be solved explicitly. This essential spectrum is zero plus infinity, and the lowest eigenvalue is minus alpha squared. So actually, this will explain this minus alpha squared in all the subsequent results. And moreover, the first eigenfunction is just the exponential minus alpha type. This is exactly this problem. I did not give a precise definition of a smooth domain, but let's say if you interpret as C1 domain, in fact, one needs a bit more, because for C1 domains, there are some travels with normal derivative, but anyway, it was shown by two steps that every fixed eigenvalue behaves at minus alpha square when alpha becomes large. But if you ask for a bit more regularity, so in fact we did it for C3 domains by some reasons, but I think one can go to C11 essentially, it's a bit technical. Then you can show the following result, that after you, maybe let's start in fact with the first order asymptotics. Then if you fix any number j, then the jth eigenvalue of our Robin Laplacian will behave as minus alpha squared minus d minus 1 h max omega, and plus some remainder. And what is h max? H max, this is the maximum value of the mean curvature on the boundary. So maybe, I don't know if I am supposed to recall what the mean curvature is. So there are people who want to know what the mean curvature is. Nobody wants to know.
There's always the question of whether one over what you're thinking for averaging with
respect. You can guess from the factors that it says. And actually, maybe another question is this normalization. I assume that it's positive when you are on the convex domain. But anyway, what is important is actually this is something which has a sign. I mean, we don't take the maximum of the absolute value, but it's somehow this is really the maximum.
So just to be sure that I'm following, that does it mean that when you are going alpha to infinity, the fundamental eigenfunction looks more and more like a function of the distance to the boundary only, and that the level lines will be, you draw the distance to the level line of the distance to the boundary, and basically you have the level line.
In fact, every question is exactly about the line I'm going to show is next. Okay. So far, this is exactly what is it. So maybe just a moment. Yeah. No, in fact, we can say a bit more about what happens along the surface, and this is actually important. So just maybe one can generalize this result also to the P Laplacian. So what is P Laplacian? I mean, if you just put, let's say, P here, then we can still analyze the first eigenvalue, and essentially the asymptotics more or less the same, except that this P will appear somehow in some coefficients. Now I will give a bit comment on your question. So, in fact, so far, minus alpha square, the origins are essentially in the normal variables. Okay, this one, actually the role of this coefficient actually seem better if you consider a more precise asymptotic. So, in fact, we have the following result. So, under the same assumptions, one has the following asymptotics. Again, if you fix a number j, then the eigenvalue behaves as follows. We have still minus alpha square, but then we have the jth eigenvalue of some operator living at the boundary, and this operator itself still depends on alpha, so it's not an asymptotic expansion still, and then plus some remainder. Okay, and what is the asymptotic, the effects of operator at the boundary? This is the this is essentially Schrodinger operator whose potential is given by the mean curvature. So in fact, depending on the precise geometry, this remainder can be comparable with the first eigenvalue. In particular, it's seen from the following reformulation. I mean, you can see that this operator is of semi-classical nature, so you can introduce the small parameter h, which alpha minus to the power minus 1 over 2, and v, this is what's written here. So if you factor out alpha, then you have exactly the semi-classical Schrodinger operator. And it is known that, in fact, the asymptotics of this operator is essentially determined by the way how the potential touches its minimal value. I mean, because, so for example, if it touches the minimal value, then, let's say, on an open set, then the eigenvalues of somehow behaving rather specific. But let's say, generically, the remainder is smaller than this part. back to your question. So, in fact, I admit that we were mostly interested in the eigenvalues, but in a sense, so this can be considered, but can be more or less reformulated in terms of eigenfunctions, where we did not prove it rigorously, but anyway, it's more or less clear what happens. I mean, it means that the first eigenfunction, in fact, you just take the associated eigenfunction of this operator, and then you multiply it by the function, by exponential, so then you must truncate it in a suitable way, because it somehow will be almost zero in the integral. This is what happens. But in fact, we still can have another localization along the boundary, but the localization it will be weaker than it is weaker than the localization in the normal variable. For example, I cannot say more because essentially, the whole semi-classical analysis is here, because everything you can have in semi-classical analysis can be produced here, so I cannot give you any more precise result. Okay, but there were some people who studied in detail cases where one can go and can provide a really very precise analysis. Well, for example, Bernard Fer, his former student, Ayman Kashmar, they studied two-dimensional domain with a curvature which admits a single non-degenerate maximum. So essentially, in this case, you can replace it by the harmonic oscillator. And in that case, they are able to produce the full asymptotic expansion in some powers of alpha. I formulated the result just for the individual eigenvalues, but in fact one can do this one can make a link between this operator and this one and many other situations. In particular, one can compute somehow how many eigenvalues, negative eigenvalues, we have when alpha becomes large. So, roughly speaking, it's proportional to the volume of the surface, which is more or less understandable. And then, okay, and some other specific question like Tumerian effect. So actually, Bernard Fair was going to say some words about it yesterday, but to the chat with his talk. So I'd say actually it's really very technical, especially Tumerian effect. So maybe I will add some, let's say, easy stuff, just because in fact this easy stuff was somehow a starting point for me to look at the problem. So this spin-off concern what is called isoperimetric inequalities. So what does it mean, an isoperimetric inequality? Essentially, you have some geometric object, you fix some geometric quantity, and you try to optimize something in other geometric quantity. So the most classical thing, which is now more or less understood, is the classical isoperimetric inequality. If you fix the volume, then the ball minimizes the area of the boundary, or the other way around. In fact, in most, let's say ball is optimal in many aspects. But this can be done also in the spectral setting. So in fact, in the spectral setting, the most, I forgot to put it to the slide, and so the most famous result is probably due to Faber-Krahn-type. So in fact, what they do is they, if you take an omega, and to omega you associate, let's say, the first Dirichlet eigenvalue of omega, and now you take a ball with the same volume. So it's can so lambda on B of B. Okay, then ball has the lowest first eigenvalue among all domains of the same volume. But of course, this is not the only possible formulation. One can look at high eigenvalues and let's say one can consider a different setting, like you fix the perimeter and not the perimeter and not the, so in fact in it's so in fact in some I was in a conference about the topic and it was really very hard, but there was a guy who arrived and who somehow announced the following result. I mean, if you walk in the class of domains with fixed perimeter, then the 22nd eigenvalue is not optimized by a family of balls. This was okay, just to understand the state of things in this domain, and like this, it's very interesting. Okay, but essentially the first eigenvalue is easier to understand, but if you go to higher eigenvalues, this becomes quite crazy. I mean, people do it in a numerical way, and in fact, if you do it numerically, you have very strange shapes. I mean, it's not so easy to come up with a conjecture in what would the optimal shape be. Yeah, but for the Robin Laplacian, in our setting, the respective conjecture was formulated by Barrett 40 years ago, and the conjecture was as follows. So if you look at domains of a fixed volume, B, it will always be a ball having the same volume as omega. So will the ball be the maximizer of the first Robin eigenvalue for all parameters alpha? So just to understand why, because before it was a minimizer, why it should be maximizer. In fact, it's easy to understand if you look at small alpha. For small alpha, in fact, you can write the Taylor expansion for the first eigenvalue. Okay, it will be zero, which is the Neumann eigenvalue, and then you have something like this, times alpha, and let's say small alpha, when alpha goes to zero. So then you see that, they said that here we have already somehow the classicalized parametric inequality. So if alpha is positive, then in order to maximize the eigenvalue, we need to minimize the boundary. So it's somehow it's natural. If there is an optimizer, then it should be one.
Is this known in the classical case alpha negative?
I mean, if you change the sign of alpha, it was proved by Daniel Daniels or something, okay. I mean, here the sign of alpha is important, I mean. For the opposite sign of alpha, it was proved a bit later, in fact. But here, this question was explicitly for this, for our sign of alpha. I mean, for the opposite, just I will try to present the state of things for this case, but I say that if you change the sign of alpha, then the problem is completely solved by people like Durand Dupuy or Daniel Daniels and so on. They contributed a lot. So, and in fact, surprisingly, the counterexample, or let's say, the answer was only obtained very recently by Pedro Freitas and David Krejcicki. The interesting point is that as a counterexample, they actually provided some very simple asymptotic study when alpha becomes large. And actually, at this point, I was interested. To understand the source of the observation, just let me recall that we have these asymptotics, but in this quantity, this is the only geometric. Let's say, let us start to look just at smooth domains. Then the only geometric quantity in the first order asymptotic is this is the maximum of the mean curvature. It means that, if we want to, so in particular, if we have this inequality for all alpha, it also holds when alpha is large. And it means that if you have this inequality, that then this quantity for the ball should be smaller than the maximum of the mean curvature for any other domain with the same volume. So this is a bit trivial, but anyway, it took some time to just to understand it. So it means that if the balls maximize the first eigenvalue in a class of domains of a fixed volume, then they also should satisfy this inequality in the same class of domains. And actually, this question is purely geometric. So one easily sees, it's essentially what they observed, that this property, in fact, does not hold in the class of all smooth domains, in particular the spherical shells. Just imagine that you have a ball and you want to compare it with dimension 2 in the spherical shell. Here we have a constant mean curvature, it's 1 over r, and here we have, let's say, 1 over 2. But here the mean curvature is minus 1 over r1, and here the mean curvature is 1 over r2. So here the sign becomes important. So it means if you look at the maximum, only the outer part counts, and on the outer part it's smaller than for the. So for the point, in fact, the symmetry is not even needed.
But then if you respect to simply connected domain.
Okay, this is exactly the next comment. Let us pass through. Anyway, this gives actually a counterexample. It does not. It actually provides with some intuition for the general problem. So and actually, it's more or less easier. It's quite easier. If you are in the business to show that this inequality holds in the class of star-shaped smooth domains, which is kind of folkloric and it follows from, let's say, Minkowski formulas. So, and it holds in the class of simply connected two-dimensional domains, so two-dimensional is important, which is actually somehow some kind of also folkloric result, but in fact, it's still, there are some people associated to that. It's a test of Anionian who did it some 60 years ago. But in fact, every year there is someone who rediscovers it. You can look at Massanet, actually there is a chain of references. Actually, I admit that I was one of the examples, so we found a nice proof through the curvature problem. So anyway, the result is true. I mean, in the case of simply connected domains, it's still true, so which may mean that this inequality could be true in the class of simply connected domains. In three-dimensional case, even if you consider domains which are diffeomorphic to a ball, this inequality is false. I tried to do it, I didn't succeed, but then I meet some Italian people who said that we do it, but anyway, for them it took 3 months to write it in an explicit way. It's really very nice, it uses the glue. They use a minimal surface, which is called nodoid, which is then glued to some other pieces, and then somehow, by taking some limits, they disprove the inequality. So in fact, in three-dimensional domain, if you fix the volume, you do not have any positive lower bound for this quantity. It can be sent to zero. This is a bit true.
was interesting. So, in fact, one should say that the estimate H plays a role in many other problems. For example, it's magnetic moment Laplacian and some others. So, in fact, there are many problems in which you are supposed to understand the maximum of the mean curvature. Okay, and of course, this is not the only possible setting. For example, you can try to understand whether this holds if you assume that, let's say, the surface area is the same for the domain for the ball, and actually it's was quite fun. There are many people doing it. In fact, it's comes the situation is a bit simpler, but somehow recently everyone was overrun by bachelor thesis written by a young lady in Moscow State University, which we discovered actually by just by chance somehow, because Google Scholar, due to the suggestion of Google Scholar, it's really useful sometimes. So anyway, I'm not sure that I can give a nice, reasonable summary for this setting. There are many results. So now back to the main topic, because the main topic it was the asymptotics of the eigenvalues. See? So now I would like to understand, the following problem. Now, so we discussed smooth domains. So how far can we go for non-smooth domains? Okay, I will continue with the following setting. So I will just, in fact, there are many non-smooth domains, let's say. So I will continue just with two-dimensional domains. Then essentially we continue with simply with polygons. I would like to avoid all curvature effects because actually it's already sufficient to have a difficult life. So I will assume that I have a polygon with V vertices, which I denote AV, then LV is a few bicyclic. In this setting, it is more reasonable to work with half angles instead of angles. So the question is, if I fix a number J, can I describe the asymptotic behavior of the J set eigenvalue of the Robin Laplacian? Now I would like to understand it for any fixed number.
Are you going to just do the simply connected case as strong?
No, it's not important, but it's not. It's not a problem.
Okay. It's just the data being asked.
Okay, yeah. In fact, in this business, you start to suffer with notations. In fact, if it's simply connected, it's a bit easier to do everything. I recall that at the beginning I explained it a bit how to recover the asymptotics of the lowest eigenvalue. So one should should understand that somehow the tangent cones can be of importance, but here the tangent cones are quite simple. So I mean you just take corners and each corner by extending to infinity you obtain an infinite center. So it would be a good idea to understand first what happens in infinite sectors. In fact, if you walk in an infinite sector, the parameter alpha is essentially of no importance. It only depends on the opening angle because you can, by a suitable dilation, you can somehow remove alpha. So we will only work with a Robin Laplacian, which only depends on theta. So in fact, here I'm not very comfortable because first of all, let's say if you work with sectors for Dirichlet and the Neumann boundary conditions, you have a separation of variables. If you pass to the polar coordinate, for example, Laplacian is not there. But somehow I still have the impression that it should be somehow with separated variables, but we do not know how to do it. But anyway, also what one can show. So it was actually the first thing done by my former doctoral student, Magda. So if you look at the Robin Laplacian in the infinite sector, this parameter is 1. Okay, then the essential sector of this operator of the essential spectrum is minus 1 plus infinity. And below minus 1, we have a finitely many eigenvalues. Okay, I will denote the number of eigenvalues by theta. So the eigenvalues are increasing in theta. So it's monotone. Okay, and then we have a series of observations. So if the sector is larger than the half plane, then there are no eigenvalues at all, which is quite easy. For all other cases, there is at least one eigenvalue. Moreover, the first eigenvalue is actually can be calculated explicitly, and the first eigenfunction as well. Okay, then if the sector is not very sharp, then there is a single eigenvalue. But if the sector becomes sharp, then the number of the eigenvalues goes to plus infinity, and each individual eigenvalue behaves in this way. When it goes to zero. So one can, in fact, I don't know what can be an analogy in terms of Schrodinger operators. You want to ask one?
Yes. It's just that it's a non-compact thing.
So yeah, no, yeah, but
it's the usual thing. It's our piece of continuous essential spectrum.
Yeah, but anyway, you should need some work to show that there are finitely many eigenvalues. But for example, if you consider a cone in the three dimensions, you have an infinite discrete spectrum, because then there is somehow interplay between the curvature and other. So here, it's not that difficult, but anyway, this is an essential point that you only have finitely many discrete eigenvalues. I don't know what happens, in fact, if there are embedded eigenvalues or not, but it's of no importance so far. And moreover, this k theta, first k theta eigenfunctions are exponentially localized near the vertex. Okay, this is again, can be checked. So in fact, this thing which looks a bit surprising for me, if you draw this sector in this way, horizontal way, it's one, then theta, then the first eigenfunction looks very simple, in fact. It's exponential minus 1 over theta. Okay, and here, it only depends on a single variable. Okay, this should be, but in fact, you can obtain it by simple variational arguments, but I don't know how to touch the next eigenfunction. So because it seems that there is something which is called Malusian, it's Sommerfeld method, but somehow I did not get through it so far.
It reminds me of Hardy inequalities, kind of weighted Hardy inequalities. There's a discrete, so there's some kind of Mellon transform, and then there's some poles some kind of analytic function based on it.
This is exactly the point of this Malusian method, but somehow we didn't get through it so far. So maybe we can discuss later.
And how time connecting that with the when alpha is quite small and you have a domain with corner like this, the fundamental eigenfunction tends to avoid the corner. It's not located in corner.
No. If alpha is very small, you have the Neumann eigenfunction, and essentially it's one.
Dirichlet
corresponds to the. Maybe I forgot to say. If you consider, in my setting, it would correspond to the opposite regime when alpha goes to minus infinity.
Okay.
It will be Dirichlet.
Alpha zero
is one. But we will see what you say. Okay. There is still this effect in this problem. We will see it on the next slide. So and now, as soon as we have some information on the sectors, so we can. This is actually already quite technical. Obtained by, let's say, standard methods, but it's still quite technical. So just what is the second maybe? Draw a picture. Do I have this picture? Okay, let's do it. Something like this. So, in fact, now to each corner you may attach, you consider the attached sector, and you consider, you consider the k theta, this is the number of discrete eigenvalues in this sector. Now you take the sum over all corners, so in particular, let's say this vertex will not contribute because there are no eigenvalues here. And then one can easily show that the first k eigenvalues of polygons, they behave as the first k eigenvalues of the direct sum of the sectors. So in fact, it corresponds more or less to the mu naught rule. This is effect. Somehow each corner acts as, can be considered as a well for Schrodinger operators. You can consider this as a well. So in fact, they are exponentially close. So the associated eigenfunction of the polygon, they are exponentially localized near the corner, and they are close in some rigorously defined sense. to linear combination of suitably truncated and rotated eigenfunctions of the sectors, which is again standard stuff. But okay, this needs some work to define it, but it was done first, let's say, one can do it. I'm not sure if it can be done in the point-wise sense, but let's say in some sense it works. But again, only convex corners contribute. Then, I mean, if you go beyond this number, then the eigenvalues have the main term in the asymptotic behavior is the same as in the smooth case, and we are going to discuss what happens in sort of the next slides. So, in fact, there is some issues if you have two or more equal angles. So, just one can be then interested in the Tumelian effect between two congruent corners, but the problem is very difficult. It's more or less has the same order of difficulty as a multiple well for Schrodinger operators. So up to now, we only considered a very particular configuration, but okay, with a double well, I mean, if you consider something like this, it's two equal corners, so in that case, you can compute it in a rather efficient way. So what happens? But in fact, the good point compared to the Schrodinger operator is that there are at least two explicit configurations where you have kind of separation of variables. So the first of them is, of course, the rectangle. But anyway, it provides us with some intuition, but there is another one which is equilateral triangle in which you can also separate variables. Okay, then, yeah, what do you mean separation of variables? I mean, you are then reduced to study just a single scalar equation, which is relatively easy. Okay, for the equilateral triangle, okay, you need to solve a system of equation, but someone did it for us. This is the good point. So now I would like to discuss actually what happens if you go beyond this critical number. Let's say we understand a bit what happens with the first k eigenvalues. We do not understand completely what happens with eigenfunctions, modulo the Tunelian effect, but let us see now what happens as soon as you go through this critical value. Okay, so now, okay, what about a more precise asymptotic for the next eigenvalues? Okay, and again, the principal term is already here. Okay, what about a more detailed representation of the remainder? So, in fact, in order to estimate the negative eigenvalue, one can use the fact that the Laplacian is a positive operator. So, in fact, in my computation, instead of doing Eggman estimates, I prefer to use what is called the Dirichlet-Eggman brackets. So if you, let's say, take your polygon, and if you take kind of epsilon neighborhood, and you impose Neumann and Dirichlet boundary condition on this artificial boundary, then the Neumann case will provide a lower bound for our eigenvalues, and the Dirichlet boundary condition will provide an upper bound. But in fact, due to Eggman estimates, they exponentially grow, in fact, so you can study one of them. It's actually, this makes the text a bit shorter because you're not obliged to improve the estimate. But now, if you look at what is drawn here, I mean, geometric area starts to look very close to the analysis of the Dirichlet-Laplacian on domains conversion to graphs, which is another actually big, so huge business. There was some significant progress kind of 10 years ago, and Daniel Grieser, he said, in fact, that it's what he did, it's a kind of simple consequence of a preceding paper with Jerison on, let's say, on some long domains small domain. So what was the context? I mean, you take a kind of, let's say, you draw a graph in the plane, and then you take a kind of epsilon neighborhood, and you study the Dirichlet-Laplacian in this domain, and you ask what happens if epsilon, the thickness, goes to zero. So intuitively, you would expect that you obtain a kind of Laplacian on this structure. Okay, this structure, now people study it under the name quantum graph, which is very fashionable, okay, functioning. Okay, but then, okay, model common divergent term, and so in fact, here, like for the Robin case, first of all, there are some eigenfunctions which are just concentrated at the vertices, but then, if you neglect them, and then there is, of course, a divergent term, which is essentially a thickness,
So 1 over epsilon squared, which is the first derivative eigenvalue of a small interval. Then the asymptotics then is determined by what is called quantum graph Laplacian. So what is quantum graph Laplacian? I mean, you consider this system of intervals. On each interval you consider the second derivative, but then they are glued together by some boundary conditions and vertices. Yeah. And in fact, the boundary conditions for the effective operator, they are supposed to be determined by the scattering matrices at the borders, which one, needs some definition. But anyway, in almost all cases, the effective transmission condition which you obtain here are Dirichlet ones. So it means that in the most cases, or at least in all the cases which you managed to analyze explicitly, in fact, there is no cutting between the edges. The edges are the cutting. So very recently, there was a new activity, let's say, how to identify some, so how to study some particular configuration. Now, okay, let us try to adapt this philosophy to the Robin case, because anyway, this is not the same problem. Okay, in fact, okay, I like this picture very much. So in fact, if you consider with your analogy, what you do, I mean, let us take your polygon and you consider the epsilon neighborhood of the boundary. Then, of course, then the shape of the neighborhood, it depends on whether or not you have concave corners, because, for example, here you have sectors, here you have some quadrangles, and so on. And in fact, you try to look at not epsilon, it's delta. And the thickness is delta, which will be small. Then you have, in fact, this thin, you may interpret the problem as follows. So you have very thin rectangles. Let's say the thickness is small, but the length is almost fixed. But then you have these vertex neighborhoods, and the problem is you are studying is that you study the interaction of these rectangles through the vertex, through the neighborhoods of the vertices. So the very first idea one could do, in fact, one can impose at these artificial boundaries is a Dirichlet or Neumann boundary eigenvalues. So the Dirichlet boundary conditions would give them an upper bound, and the Neumann boundary condition would then give a lower bound. The problem is that it doesn't give it gives some information, but it does not give a precise asymptotics, because the remainder you obtain is still very large. And in particular, it's very difficult to control this part when you impose the Neumann boundary condition. But let's say what we do, we follow the usual philosophy in mathematics. So if we have some trouble, we use a definition, we introduce a definition. So I mean, there is a definition to give a special name to a situation when everything works in a nice way. So in our case, so after several iterations, we decided to call it a non-resonant corner because it sounds cool. So in fact, I will try to understand. So anyway, everything is very naive. In fact, it's not the most advanced mathematics here. So again, so far we studied the. At some point we looked at infinite sectors, but now let us consider truncated sectors. I mean, we take some distance r, then we take two perpendiculars, and we consider these quadrangles. In this quadrangle, we consider the following operator. So we have the Laplacian, we have the Robin boundary condition on these two sides, and we put Neumann boundary conditions on these two new sides. So, and we know that the first k theta, the parameter here is theta. In fact, two of them are theta. So the first two, the first k theta eigenvalues, they converge to the eigenvalues of the whole sector. And our assumption is, in fact, on the next eigenvalue. So we say that the corner is non-resonant if the eigenvalue with the number k theta plus 1 behaves in the following way. It's the bottom of the essential spectrum and plus something we are able to control. Okay, it looks a bit strange, but anyway, this is exactly what helps in what follows. And okay, this looks a bit crazy, but anyway, a nice observation is that this condition can be checked for a range of corners. In particular, if for all sectors which are bigger than all corners, theta
larger than p over 4, it means that the sector is larger than the quarter of the plane. I mean, all these corners are non-resonant. Okay, now let us, okay, this is the main result in this direction, which is, seems to be the only one which is available, and actually took several months to write it in a readable way. So now, so again, we are still in the context, so our context is that omega is, okay, is a polygon. So if all corners of omega are concave or non-resonant, so we can have a mixture of them. I mean, if each corner is either concave or non-resonant, in particular, if all corners, all half angles are larger than p over 4, then for each fixed j, one has these asymptotics. So in here, this is exactly what you said, that the corner is non-repulsive. I mean, in this case, okay, we have the divergent term, but then there is an effective operator, and the effective operator is just the direct sum of Dirichlet Laplacian on Dirichlet Laplacians on each edge. Well, what does mean Dirichlet Laplacian? That in fact that you should impose somehow the Dirichlet boundary condition at the corner. So it means that so in fact. But anyway, we did it for the eigenvalues. Okay, for the eigenfunction, it's very, it's not obvious. So why it's not obvious? Because it's,
you don't see the parameter lambda in the middle term, the alpha in the middle term.
Here, there is no alpha.
Hmm?
There is no alpha here.
Right, so you're saying that that's constant in alpha, but this other term, oh, that's right, this is small, this goes to zero.
Yeah, exactly.
There's a square root of alpha. Okay.
Yeah, but this is exactly the point that the effective operator does not depend on alpha anymore. In fact, for example, you cannot say about kind of exponential localization, right? Or actually, I do not know how to do it. Anyway, you can, you could, what we did, what we do is somehow we construct a kind of approximate eigenfunctions which vanish at corners and somehow they show. So, I believe it can be made rigorous also for eigenfunctions. But, so, in fact, I do not, we do not, in fact, there are many places at which it's not it's not optimal. So first of all, I don't believe that the remainder is optimal. Yeah, but okay, it can be, it can sound, and of course, when I, so people smiled when I said several words about the fact that, for example, a rectangle is with separated variables, but the rectangle is in fact within the range of the domains which are described by the theorem, and then you can, of course, do a more precise computation, then here you have one over alpha. This would be probably the optimal one, but I do not know whether it is an aspect effect. But anyway, but of course, the more the another the something which is a bit, probably a bit more interesting is that whether you need some condition for the corners. And if in fact yes, why I don't believe that I do not believe that this condition is optimal. But anyway, one needs some condition, some assumption on the corners. So for example, if you consider the equilateral triangle, then one can do a kind of separation of variables, and one can, for the equilateral triangle, you have three first eigenfunctions which are concentrated at the corners, but then, so if you understand what the computations on 30 pages are, if you put the summary, then you have still a kind of, so this result, then you have a kind of effective operator, but the effective operator not just the direct sum of Dirichlet Laplacian, but then the effective operator, it would be just the Laplacian on the whole boundary without any obstacle. And so it can be. In fact, it's not. I mean, it's seen from the just for direct computation. There is no real philosophy behind that. It's just you do the computation and it's like that. I mean, because somehow the numbers you obtain here, they are exactly the numbers of this. But in particular, why is it not compatible with what is written here? Because if you take the first eigenvalue, it's zero. While here, the first eigenvalue is always positive. It means that the fourth eigenvalue behaves in this way. So there is the middle term zero, and here it is non-zero. So it means that there are corners which are non-resonant, which can then be called resonant. Okay, it's a bit, it's much more technical to study the curvilinear polygons, while in fact I would expect that one has, should have an analogous result if you have curvilinear polygon with concave or non-resonant corners, then you have a more or less the same asymptotic as a smooth case, starting with this number, whether with somehow with a Dirichlet boundary condition on the corner, but it's really somehow it's a mess. I mean, in computations, maybe it's our philosophy is not optimal. So somehow it's, so moreover, my PhD student now left to Germany, so I'm not sure if you continue.
Maybe one should look for another for the method.
Okay, I don't think maybe I would do my service to the meeting if I stop here and I don't, because actually the proof is, okay, I'm not sure that it will be understandable, but it's somehow technical. Yeah, but I will maybe just say some concluding words. So in fact, my main concern is our strange definition of a non-resonant corner, which looks a bit artificial, but we took it as a naive adaptation of some sufficient condition which you obtain when you study waveguides, because I'm saying the waveguides, and this is what I mean by waveguides, this configuration. And somehow there is a well-developed theory, and then I just tried some conditions, and one of them worked very well. But in fact, a good condition, it would be probably like this. I mean, you study this sector, and you would like to understand if you have if you can find the so-called threshold resonance. I mean, if you try to look at the spectral problem at the threshold of the essential spectrum, but in fact you do not look for L2 solutions, but let's say for something like bounded. This would be kind of resonance. This would be something which would glue contributions of two edges coming from two sides. But anyway, so it's a project. In fact, the correct definition of non-resonant corners should probably make use of suitably defined scattering matrices. So we need to understand how to define the scattering matrices in such a structure, which we are also, so far we did not arrive at that question. And in particular, our expectation is in fact is as follows. Okay, the theta, this is the number of discrete eigenvalues in the sector, and so this function is a monotone and piecewise constant, and I expect that if theta is not a jump of this function, then the respective angle should be non-resonant, which is, this is something which you see in other problems with resonances, but again, so far we are in a slightly unusual setting in order to apply it. So thank you very much. So for question, by the way, I am always here and I live 300 meters from this building, so that I can hear you. You can have some later.
But then you wouldn't do a favor.
Ah, okay, careful.
No, I see what you mean. Maybe some question.
I have a comment, and maybe a couple of comments.
Yeah.
The first one is that there's a numerical program which was designed by Toby Driscoll, who's a student of Nick Trefethen, which solves the eigenfunction problem in polygons. And it's based mostly on conformal mapping, and it does the Dirichlet problem and the Neumann problem. And I think what you've shown is that that same method can actually literally be implemented. It's essentially based on these kinds of expansions for those two problems, but the Robin problem is, with this extra parameter, is the same thing. So I mean, it doesn't have to do with asymptotics, but it's a totally practical thing, which probably would that's just a remark. There's an actual software out here that does this in concrete cases. If you get some lovely examples, if you get that one. The other comment that I want to make is that you've already referred to it implicitly in this last thing is that it sounds to me like some Fredholm operator with a complex parameter, and that it's certain when you have multiplicity you have more complicated expansion, maybe with log terms or something like that. But in fact, there's sort of a general statement. Discontinuities have to do with shifting dimensions. This has happened in a number of problems like this. So it's realistic to expect this last thing to be to be true, that this is the correct definition.
Yeah, but I'm saying somehow one has some intuition, but what I'm presented is what we managed to prove rigorously.
Yeah, that's right. Right. I mean, it's realistic to expect it to happen. There's more to come from. So that's fair.
I have a very stupid question, so I should just come home and he's locked down.
I don't know.
I mean, I guess Robin waited something?
No, but I think, you'll be a very good coefficient.
Computing the control mapping is already hard.
So the polygon is supports the stop formula. That's not a big crystal.
That's part of what he uses, but that doesn't solve the problem. That's just the formula. I can explain it very clearly. That's not the issue.
You mean how to
Schwartz Kostopoulos formula is easy and works always, but that isn't the solution to the question.
Well, I was not understanding.